All right, hey everybody, welcome to today's podcast. This is about getting tips from the trenches. This is about helping you guys as contractors take your contracting business to the next level. I'm Andrew Houston here from Profit for Contractors. And today we're going to talk about, I guess you'd call it resiliency, like how to get through challenging times. And I'm here with my man, Matt. Welcome, Matt.
Hey, everybody.
Matt, maybe introduce yourself. Tell us a little bit about who you are, then we're going to get right into this.
Yeah, Matthew McKellar. I work with PFC doing some mindset work and kind of providing a place for people to open up and connect and slow down, especially, and just, you know, really say what's on their mind and really get all the stuff that they're keeping in out and to lighten that burden and to also provide some insights so that people can really see the path forward clearly. And I do coaching on my own, and yeah, I just love to dive deep with people. So that's my passion.
I love it, dude. So look it, we're dealing with interesting times. We got this COVID-19 happening. You know, we'll be looking back on podcasts like this going, man, that was crazy times. So, yeah. You know, let's talk about that. I mean, it is a little bit crazy, and you know, I wanted to give some guidance, some insight between you and me, just chatting about how people can get through this and not just survive through it, thrive through it, grow through it. And that, in all honesty, to be straight up, man, there is, as an entrepreneur, there's going to be lots more challenges like this, right? There's going to be tons of challenges going on when it comes to being an entrepreneur. And this is maybe just an amplified one. So let's dig into, you know, some of the key things that we want to make sure that we talk on today. We want to give you guys some, you know, strategies, let you know you're not alone, you know, let you know that, you know, that there's ways around this and there's ways to benefit from this, you know, and I think that's one of the biggest things, right, that we got to get into is, well, how the hell do you go about doing that? How do you not let these times crush you? How do you let these times get you to become stronger? And how have you and I gotten through it and others and ended up on the other side? You know, like a $1 million man, stronger, faster, right? Mm-hmm. Smarter, hopefully, today. So, Matt, what's some of the things you want to make sure we table? Some of the key questions we want to get into or kick off with here?
Yeah, I think for me, it always starts where you're actually at. So I guess I would ask you, and just wondering how this thing hit you personally and what it brought up for you. And I'll share as well myself.
Yeah. Man, it's brought up a lot. I think, you know, when we talk about this, you know, with giving you guys tips from the trenches, I mean, we're in the trench, right? We're literally in the trench dealing with this situation. So how it's hit me, I'll be straight up with you. You know, one of the things that I've learned throughout time is not to get immediately sucked into things too quickly. You know, remember when this first started, you know, getting, let's call it announced, I call it marketed by the news and the media. And yes, everybody, it is marketing. You know, this is probably, they're probably going to be making the most amount of money out of this freaking thing. I'm not saying that it's not a major challenge. I'm not saying it's not real, but yeah, when it first came, I was watching, you know, my friends, you know, the old, you know, techs going like crazy. Oh my God, you see this announcement, see that announcement? And it was like, honest to God, it was like, it felt like every minute, maybe it was every 5 minutes, I don't know. And whenever that's happened, I literally, to a certain degree, turn it off. Mm. Because there's been so many times in my life where things are made a lot bigger than what they actually are. And also that I've come to realize, you know, getting sucked into this vortex of distraction, to a certain degree, it, you know, it's distraction, is going to slow me down, slow my team down. Yeah, so I think the very first way that it hit me was, okay, how can I not let this take me off my game? How can I not let this distract me and you know, make my environment a fucking walking gray cloud of you know, bullshit, like to a certain degree, And that applied to my kids too. You know, so very quickly I said to my wife, inclusive of my friends, like, I don't want to be on that thread. Like, it's just too much for me. Oh, and then, hey, you know, then the judgment comes in. Well, Andrew, like, aren't you worried about your kids? Yeah. So I look at the news once or twice a day. Like, what the fuck am I going to do in between, you know, six in the morning, in the morning. I mean, I get up at four, but say whatever, 8 o'clock till 8 o'clock at night or whatever. What the hell am I going to fucking do about it? Like, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And I don't know, maybe that was a little bit, no, I don't know. I'm sure some people thought that was irresponsible. I thought it was being more responsible. I mean, turning it off completely. Okay. Now that's foolish. But looking at it and getting sucked into it and like making your day shit. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I've learned the hard way that that's not a place that's good for me, mindset wise. And it's not a good place for me to be as a leader.
I mean,
if I'm talking to my kids and my kids, every time they pass me, you know, every time I'm home, we're watching the news going, Oh my God. I mean, what's that going to do to my kids? Now I got a couple of kids, I love them to death, and they've got some sensitivity to certain things and anxiety and stuff like that. So I've got extra, you know, spidey senses around that. But yeah, that was my first approach, was like, okay, hold it. Okay. It's important to know, but to what degree?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and what do I got to do to keep moving forward?
Yeah.
So, and what about you? Like, how did you, you know, start dealing with this?
Yeah. So this one's been interesting for me because I feel like it hit me pretty hard in a sense that, well, I guess, well, the hardest it's hit me is that, you know, losing some money in the stock market, first of all. So it's like, I feel like I'm in the beginning of the road of building up my adult resources, my, you know, career, all this stuff. You know, I'm in the beginning stages of this stuff. And so it really made me angry at myself for not being in a better position, you know, not having even on a primal level, like not having, not that this is that bad, but it could have been these viruses could have been way worse, to the point where you actually might need to go to some cabin or something for a while and like get away. And I kind of was beating myself up for not having the resources already to have a cabin, to have some ability to, you know, get real supplies, not prepper stuff, but just, you know, some kind of
sure
getting out of a major city kind of resources.
Yeah.
So that was one thing. And then the other was just having like proper anxiety attack for 4 days. Like, I haven't had anxiety for a long time, just out of nowhere. I've had just, you know, acute anxiety about certain things. And, you know, if I'm in a tent in the middle of nowhere and I'm worried about a bear, my fight or flight will go off and I won't be able to control it and just have a really miserable sleep. And then I wake up and I'm all right. But this was like 3 or 4 days of, cause I was kind of feeling sick, and I was worried that I had, because I was, when I was younger, I had asthma, and I had been hospitalized once for pneumonia, but, so I was worried that I was susceptible to this virus more than other people. And so so it brought up a lot of anxiety for me, and irrational anxiety, like just uncontrollable kind of, I just felt sick and felt like the flu almost. And I've had waves of it since it sort of relaxed on me. And, you know, I think that, like, for me, I always, especially now, I'm trying to find the teaching lesson in everything, like not in a cliche way, but in a real way. There's a real way that this anxiety is bringing me closer to myself and understanding myself better, because I realized that I was talking to my ex-girlfriend's a therapist, and we're constantly talking about these kinds of things, and she always talks about you know, people avoiding their pain. And what she means by that is everyone needs to, at some point in their life, kind of really own the reality of their childhood, the pain that they felt, all these different things, and move on from it. make it real, get support for it, but then also take action and really move forward. And we have this thing called, like, you know, avoiding your pain. And I what this brought up for me was, like, the things I do to check out in life and distract myself, they're not to avoid pain. They're to avoid this anxious feeling. And I didn't realize that till, like, literally yesterday or the day before. I was like, I can handle any physical pain. Like, I'm pretty good. You know, I did extreme sports. I don't mind getting smashed up a bit, whatever. But there's this, like, nauseous anxiety feeling that to me feels like the worst feeling ever. And I realized that when I dig down deep enough on myself, and that I think that that's there, that's down there. And that's the thing I'm avoiding whenever I'm, you know, avoiding things, or it's like I had this anxious feeling. And I didn't realize that till a couple of days ago. And now I've got to work through what that is and how I get through that. But I had that realization because how intense of a situation this is. It's really,
it's interesting.
Yeah. Focused me onto something.
It's interesting because there's a lot to be said about that. You know, I think times like this brings, you know, and we'll talk about a lot of different avenues, inclusive of business and personal. That's what you're, you know, talking about, is how times like this brings to the surface, you know, issues or things that we've got to deal with, right? You know, I talk about, you know, back to all you contractors out there, and we talk about, you know, the old leaky pipe, right? And then, you know, it's just a leak. It's just a drip. What's the big deal? I just put a bucket on it. I'll clean it up once in a while. And then the pressure, for some reason, pressure comes through the pipe. And next thing you know, it's a fucking disaster, mm-hmm. right? I think, you know, and I'm not saying it's a disaster for you, but it's the, you know, the analogy is that these little fissure cracks or crevices, you know, become canyons. Mm-hmm. In, you know, our own identity of who we are. And it's mm-hmm. funny that, you know, now that I heard your side of it, it's like you handled it, and there's no right or wrong anybody here. Okay. Just want to be clear. There's no right or wrong. There's no judgment to anybody listening in or judgment to you, Matt. It's interesting to hear your side of it and my side of it. And I'm not saying that I've addressed all the issues that I have, or I don't think that ever happens, right? Because we're not meant to address them all, mm-hmm. Because new ones are going to come in, and you know, and we're meant to grow, right? So, I mean, how you're handling this, I'm sure is a lot of people can relate to. I'm not sure how many people can relate to me, but you know, I used to feel like you feel.
Mm-hmm.
And I got some serious help. It took a long time for me to get help. So I went and saw psychiatrists, psychologists, and things of that nature. And, you know, I definitely had issues regarding anxiety and things of that nature, and dealing with issues with my, you know, I love my dad to death. And, you know, like I had to deal with certain things. And fortunately enough, I was able to deal with professionals that could help me walk through it. Mm-hmm. Even though I was brought up in a realm, I'm first generation Canadian, both my parents are from Ireland. So, you know, immigrants, and, you know, they're tough, man. Fucking tough. It's like tough. You and I have talked about this, like your dad who's Polish, right? Like, mm-hmm. you know, what's the accent? How would your dad say it? Like about being tough?
He'd say, you know, oh, Matt, you just have to get out there and do it.
That's right.
He talked to me in the last couple of days about, because, you know, he's just like, yeah, you know, he's like you in a way that he has that strategy of being able to move through stuff really fast.
Yeah.
But he does it, I think he does it in a slightly unhealthy way. I think you're probably more sorted out and have an, you know, so with your family, you'd have a more emotional range and like.
Oh, no, totally. Totally.
Yeah. So I feel like he's not like you in that way, but he does have that kernel of like that, just, he doesn't go there. It doesn't dwell.
So funny.
You know what I mean?
We should create a whole list of like what our immigrant parents would say, right? My dad, he would say, suck it up, Andy. Suck it up. Right? Right? That's what he'd say. It's seriously. For Christ's sakes, man, it's not that bad, right? Like, you could be under the ground right now. what the fuck, what's that mean, Dad? But like, I'm dealing with this situation. Yeah, well, fucking, so are other people, right? You could be at fucking war, for Christ's sakes. You have bullets, you know, being shot behind you. Just suck her up and get her fucking done. I'm like, Dad, I fucking love you, man. Like, seriously, like, you know, seriously. Hey, if there's a bar brawl, my dad, you know, my dad's 86. Take my dad, put him in there, because he'd be just like, let's fucking get at her. You know, instead of like, oh my God, I got in trouble last night in a fight. He's like, man, I got the shit kicked out of me last night. Man, that was awesome. It's like, what are you fucking, are you nuts, dude? Right? So, you know, it's interesting though. I got to say, coming back to getting help, I think it's really important that people reach out for help, because one of the things that I've got to say, and I'm always working on myself, man. I wish other family members of mine would do the same thing, because there's a lot of challenges, right, that we go through. And entrepreneurs go through, in my personal opinion, an amplified version, okay? They got to be the leader. They got to, you know, you talk about sucking it up. I mean, maybe it's not the right way of saying it, but you got to be being a leader. You don't go in the battle, man, and the leader going, okay, guys, like, I think we're going to lose.
Mm-hmm.
No, the leader wakes up, goes, holy fuck, man, she's going to be a rough day today. And then walks out and goes, all right, guys, let's get her done. Right? Like, otherwise, nothing's going to get done. Like, you got to be moving forward, right? And as a leader, as an entrepreneur, a lot of freaking pressure, man. You got pressure from the family, you got pressure from the kids, you got pressure from, you know, if you're a husband, a lot of our clients are husband-wife teams, right? And, you know, they really, you know, there's that business and personal is just meshed together, right? So in trying times like this, like what do you do and how do you get through it? And I think one of the biggest things is you've got to reach out for help. With that being said, I got my team always poking at me saying, Andrew, like, share some of these fucking resources that we created for these people. So with that being said, we created what's called the Contractor Survival Guide, everybody. So the Contractor Survival Guide is just about that. It's about getting help. It's about, you know, strategies right from the trenches that can help you guys, you know, how to work with your employees virtually, how to fucking leverage that to expand your geographic area. I mean, we got hundreds of these strategies, but they're not bullshit strategies. They're strategies, you know, that other contractors, clients have used. Like, right beside the strategy is the testimonial, like in the last week or two, of like, hey man, here's how I'm getting through COVID-19. I use this strategy and it helped me do this. It helped my, you know, my team see me as a leader like this. And you know what I mean? So guys, if you want to get a copy of the Contractor Survival Guide, there's a couple of ways you can get that. You definitely want to look at joining what's called the Contractor Tips Group. And the Contractor Tips Group is like-minded contractors trying to help each other. There's, I think we're almost at 3,000 contractors in there right now. It's fucking amazing, man. Everybody helping everybody. But we have inside there the survival guide. And actually we're doing a training on that, walking through it step by step tonight. So get into the Contractor Tips Group, guys. Find that on Facebook. You know, yes, there's a couple of questions to get in there. Why? Because we're very protective. I don't want jackasses getting in there and people that are naysayers and, you know what I mean? Like, people that just aren't really serious about helping themselves and helping others. So if you want to get the Contractor Survival Guide, reach out to us. If you're part of our Contractor Tips Group already, you can message us. Just type, just send to me, survival guide, and we'll get it out to you guys, because we're really here passionate about helping you guys not just survive, but thrive through this. So yeah, I think getting help, I got myself some help. I'm constantly getting help. I believe in getting help. You know, like, think about it. All these, you know, look how much experience you had to get, Matt, before you came really, really good on the, you know, say on the motocross, it was BMX, right?
Yeah.
On the BMX circuit, right? Like, it takes time, guys. It does. And I'm not going to bullshit anybody. It's fucking hard work. You know, dealing with your own identity issues, okay, and challenges is what you're meant to do. That's how you get stronger, right? I think one of the things that I was always taught, and this is my mom, a super wise woman, she always said to me, she goes, don't wish for not having challenges. I was like, what are you talking about, mom? You know, when I own my own contracting business, oh, mama, I can't find anybody. I can't make any money. Oh, there's no good clients out there. She's like, Really? So for every contractor out there, none of them have good clients. None of them make money. None of them. I'm like, well, I didn't say that. Well, I mean, sounds like they figured it out. Unless your answer is yes, that everybody's, you know, losing at this game. I'm like, she goes, Andrew, so many people have similar challenges. You either find other people that have solved them, right? And mm-hmm. and do what they did. You know, Andrew, I never told you to cheat on tests in school, but once now I can tell you to go cheat in a good way. I'm like, what? Mom, what do you mean? Andrew, don't try and figure all this shit out yourself. Get other people to help you, man. Well, she wouldn't say it like that. My mom would say, Andrew, you know, you're smart. You're a smart boy. You know, but you don't think you have all the answers. Don't think you need to have all the answers. There's got to be other people that have these some of these answers. It might not going to be one person. It might be different people. And this is a great opportunity for you to learn. But always ask yourself, do you think that you're the only one dealing with this problem? Mm-hmm. I'm like, the answer always is no. Do you think other people have solved it in this whole world? Yeah, go find those people. Mm-hmm. And that gives you hope, I think. No, I think that's a good strategy. Like for you, dealing with the anxiety. You think you're, I mean, you can't think you're the, I don't know, I shouldn't say it that way, but do you think you're the only one dealing with these kind of issues?
No. And also, you know, just even hearing you, I mean, I heard you talk about you having anxiety before in previous calls, and then even just you reiterating it just now gave me some relief. I was like, oh, right. Okay. Andrew's felt that before. He's probably felt like the extreme pain of and discomfort of anxiety, but yet, you know, here he is doing what he needs to do. And he's not, I guess you're probably beyond it in a lot of ways, but I'm sure it comes up every now and then. But you support it, of course.
Look, guys, don't think that I'm not dealing with, like, I'm like this super freaking man with a cape on. Okay, fucking waking up in the middle of the night, freaking, you know, getting up to go for a piss, can't go to sleep because I can't stop thinking. Head soaked with sweat. I'm like, man, what's going on? Years of that, mm-hmm. while writing in a diary. And by the way, with this tone, this is not negative. Everybody, you should be trying this shit, okay? Going to fucking yoga, going to the gym, mm-hmm. trying martial arts, you know, getting a fucking punching bag in the downstairs so there's no excuses. Like, you know, going for walks with my wife, that, by the way, that was huge. That one and the old writing in the diary was really, really beneficial, but it didn't nail it. You know, sitting down, talking with my kids, I mean, you know, dealing with challenges. Yeah, anybody that has kids, you guys know what I'm talking about, right? Especially in today's times. I mean, kids having anxiety, you know, and challenges like that is like through the freaking roof because of what I said earlier. Because they're looking at their fucking phones, looking at just like the news. Oh, problem. What are you going to think? Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah. So, you know, and I think surrounding myself with freaking awesome people, you know, has been like yourself and Liam and Stephanie and the team, you know, we got, you know, and just recognizing the strength of other people to know that, you know, other people can do it. Mm-hmm. You know, we got a member of our team. I'm not going to say who, but we got a member of our team that's dealing with, like, you know, going through cancer treatments and stuff like that. Like, what the fuck? What's my problem? Yeah, have we had a bunch of clients go, oh, you know, questioning, oh, should they be investing in, you know, in proper contracts and stuff? Yeah. Is that brutal after we've gotten them incredible results, change their lives? And they're like, yeah, you know what? But, you know, I'm like, what? Were we like the second or third person that you engage with? Well, yeah. Well, why is that? Is because you thought that we'd say it's okay? You know? And they're like, well, yeah. I'm like, no, it's not fucking okay. If there ever was a time for us to help you, it's now. And whether it's us, if there's ever a time to reach out and get help, you know, whether it's getting a book or reading or going to, you know, oh, I can't work out, bullshit. Many, many people, man, don't go to the gym and they're in a hell of a lot better shape than any of us. Mm. Okay?
Yeah.
So, you know, I think, you know, recognizing these problems, man, that it's okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. And to fucking never give up and persevere, that you're going to find a solution. I'm going to share something very, very personal on this podcast. Mm-hmm. Okay. At least I think it's pretty personal to me. So, you know, there came a certain point where, and I'm not promoting this, there came a certain point where I had to go and try some medication. Okay. And here I was dealing with, you know, say a family member that eventually they had to, you know, take medication. And I'm like, how incongruent is that of me not to be open to this when that approach has worked for this other person, mm-hmm. who, by the way, has tried a ton of different strategies. And it's not like they didn't work. They've helped, but it didn't get them to where they needed to be. So like I'm on medication right now to help me with my anxiety. It's mm-hmm. been a complete game changer, man. Because it's not just one thing that's going to help you. Mm-hmm. And you got to find out what it is going to be for you, man. I worked on this stuff, this headspace stuff, anxiety stuff for years, man. And I'm telling you what, I'm so glad I did, because not only did I get on the other side, but I'm able to say to other people authentically that all you guys can get on the other side. So, you know, I mean, how do you, you know, when you look at some of the techniques that you have used that have been successful, what have been some of the strategies for yourself, Matt?
Well, I think that your pipe analogy actually is like the greatest thing I've heard in a while here, because I feel like right now I fell into a trap of, oh, I feel great, so I don't need to do all these things to the highest degree I can. So I slacked off on working out, on meditate. Like I meditate, but not enough, like not to a point where I'm really getting anywhere, just enough to slow down, to get into my body. Mm. I don't have as much support as I probably could in my life, because I'm, you know, don't want to invest in a therapist or don't want to invest in a coach or whatever it is. And it's like, now that the pipe is burst, I'm trying to like, I'm like, now I'm like, okay, I'm panicking. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to stop drinking coffee. I'm going to meditate every morning, do yoga. And I'm trying to do all the tricks now, not the tricks, but I'm trying to do all the,
you're trying to catch up, actually.
Yeah. And it's like, you're trying to catch up with a tsunami of intensity going on in your body and in your system, and it doesn't really work. And so this is actually a huge lesson, and putting into that pipe analogy for me is really great, because I feel like this is a wake up call for me to be like, okay, no, you've got to invest in yourself and do that work when you feel good, when the sun is shining, when you're making money, when you're doing whatever, you've got to do those health things, mm-hmm. because when you feel like shit, you are not going to have the resources to suddenly build this structure. Mm-hmm. And so that for me is a very, very important thing, because I can get caught up just, oh, I feel great, I'm going to feel great forever.
You know, I just had a breakthrough.
Oh, yeah? Mm-hmm.
And I think about this, and look at, yeah, like I say, guys, that's like, we all deal with challenges, okay? I honestly, I'm not going to say I know what the fuck I'm talking about here, okay? I you know, people are like, oh, my God, Andrew, sometimes like, oh, you're so good, or, you know, you've mastered this. Bullshit. I'm never going to say I've mastered. You know, we can say we're given a training on this regarding mastery, you know, becoming a master, but you're always evolving. And here's a bit of the aha moment that I was just thinking about as I was listening to you, right? And I was thinking, so I got this weird thing in my head that when I'm authentically listening, but there's another side of me that's actually having a conversation with what it's hearing, right? I don't know if anybody else can relate to that, or maybe I don't know. A little off the rails here. But I think what the biggest thing that's allowed, a couple of big things that's allowed me to get through some challenging times and not be so freaking, like not freaking out during times like this. Number one is what my mom said. Okay. Is that people, like somebody might say, hey, what do you mean, Andrew? You know, other people have gone through it. I mean, this is the COVID-19. Okay, people. Remove COVID-19, called World War fucking One. Okay. How about that one? How about World War II? Okay. How about freaking the Great Depression? How, like, guys, come on. Are you kidding me? Like, you know, there's been some massive freaking challenges in this world. Okay. And there will always be. All right. And just knowing that you're not alone. Knowing that when you ask yourself that question, remove COVID-19 and go, are there other people that are dealing with anxiety and challenges and not knowing and not having all the answers? Yes. Okay. What specifically is it that I'm being challenged with? And sometimes you won't know, sometimes you will know. But definitely and for sure, try to identify the ones that might be right in front of your nose. Mm-hmm. Okay? Just by having conversations with other people.
Yeah.
Don't do it alone. Okay? So again, number one, know that you're not alone and don't do it alone. Okay? Mm-hmm. Number two is this. You know, somebody asked me one time, they said, are you ever going to be happy, Andrew? I said, what do you mean happy? Well, you're always striving for more. Is it ever going to be enough? I said, well, actually, those are two different questions.
Mm-hmm.
I said, I'm actually a very happy guy. Well, sometimes you don't seem to be. I said, why? Why is that? You know, they're like, well, just sometimes you don't seem. Said, guys, when I'm on the fucking ice and playing nets and some guy's in front of my crease, I'm not happy. What's that got to do with anything? It's the same with anything. Anybody that's competitive in sports, like you or myself or other people, you don't have to be a sports person, but I'm just saying, if you're competitive in nature, there will always be bounce between like, oh my God, we won it, to like, fuck man, we're, you know, it's the bottom of the ninth, we're losing, let's go. Like, and that's okay, all right? So what's my point in this? Number two is this. Always put pressure on the pipe. Always put pressure in the pipe. Don't wait for external forces to put pressure on the pipe. That's the wrong time. And it doesn't mean you can't recover, Matt, or anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mean you can't recover this. But if you're constantly, as an entrepreneur, putting pressure to change, that it's never enough, fuck, I'll tell you what. Your ability to see cracks are way more frequent than anybody else. So when other things come, you've already learned from those cracks so that they don't become crevices or floods.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're constantly, it's never enough. No, and to answer the question, no, it's never going to be enough for me to the day I fucking die.
Mm-hmm.
Why would I want it to be? So that's number two, okay? Is it's okay. I think a great principle is in leadership is like, to live by it's never enough. That doesn't mean like never enough money. I mean, but it's never enough. I mean, there's always more to be learned to push yourself. I don't have to do this. I could shut this whole thing down. I've done well enough throughout my time. So why would you do this? What is this, Matt? This is like a fourth podcast. I'm not totally comfortable in doing this. You guys might think I am. I'm not. I'm not that comfortable a lot of the times.
Mm-hmm.
Well, those are ways to consistently become stronger. So that's number two.
Yeah.
Okay. And number three is that, you know, always having that ability to grow. It really gets you to get prepared when you're not even preparing. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I think we've got to always strive for being better and recognize that, you know, like too many people listening in on this or maybe in the mindset, like they've already gotten sucked into the rabbit's hole. And if you go too deep in the hole, you can't get out. That's the problem. Mm-hmm. Or to get out, it's really tough. And so, you know, asking better questions is maybe the last one. Like, what are some of the questions that you're asking yourself, Matt, you know, that to make this an opportunity versus a curse?
Well, for me, it's really coming down to, boiling down to my why. And I think that's a big part of this is like, when you hit the walls, when you come up to challenges, whether they're this challenge or other challenges, it makes you kind of confront like why you're doing it. And you have just articulated very clearly that A, you've taken quitting off the table because it doesn't suit you. You haven't grown up that way. That's not an option. And you're lit up by going forward, you're someone who's actually very an amazing example of mindset, because you're the ideal growth mindset person in that.
What are you talking about?
You know, because you get genuinely lit up by problems and by challenges. I don't mean big problems, but like puzzles and trying to solve, you know, how are we going to do this? How are we going to do that? Okay, let's get going. Like, take action. And that's the way, that's kind of like in a nutshell how anyone who succeeds at anything moves forward, whether it's a basketball player or a hockey player or entrepreneur. It's like, you've got to get yourself, you got to know why you're doing what you're doing, which for you sounds like to grow and to help people. And then you've got to understand that you've got to somehow use all these tools to get yourself to be okay with challenge and be okay with growth and be okay with stepping forward into fear, into uncomfortableness. Because just to sum it up for me, that's the one thing that there's certain things you know to be true 100% because of experience. And I was a very anxious kid. I was always an outgoing kid. I was, you know, I had friends. I was played hockey my whole life, like summer and winter, three teams, all that stuff. But I was still very anxious because of my childhood trauma and this really horrible situation that I had to face at times. And I had an anxiousness in me. I was I could be fine all day at school running around and then, you know, be walking home from the bus in a very safe neighborhood thinking a van was going to kidnap me. Like, I really thought that way. And then I would go home and play outside all day. Like, I was that kind of duality. But when I discovered extreme sports, one day I was like at this club. It was like a party night. And I was walking around the club and I literally was like, oh my God, I have no anxiety anymore. I have no social anxiety. I have no anxiety. I would go to like sketchy towns in the States to ride and drive myself there. I was facing, and I'm not the kind of person that should have ever been doing extreme sports. Like, I am not the kind of person that just hucks at things. In my head, everything I faced, I would look at some rail I'm doing or something and say, my brain goes, okay, you're going to crack your head open on that step. You're going to break your leg on that thing. You're going to knock yourself out on that. And then I'd have to go, okay, I'm going to do it anyway. Where I had friends who would just fire at it. And I don't even know if they were thinking about the repercussions, but my brain. So it was very hard for me. What I'm trying to say, it was very hard for me to do extreme sports because I had to get over my natural reaction, which was fear. It was like, holy shit, I'm going to crash on this. I'm going to get so hurt. It's going to be so painful. And then we had this rule where it was like, you could only take three, I don't know if this is any more politically correct, but we call them bitch runs, where like, if you were going to slide down a rail, handrail on the pegs, whatever, you could only go at it three times to look at it. Because if you went more than three, yes, you're not totally going to do it.
Totally agree. Yep.
So it was like the third one, you're going down there no matter what happens.
That's true.
Because otherwise you will freeze up and you will just ride around and look at it a million times. And I mean, you know, so that's kind of like a lesson I learned. That's like stepping towards the fear, stepping towards the, and opening. That's the other thing. It's like,
so I got a question for you. Yeah. I got a question. So you've hurt yourself doing that many times, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, totally. Okay. So what was it, and I'm going someplace with this. What was it that got you to get back up, even if a broken ankle or whatever, to get back up? Like, you felt that pain, man. Like, holy fuck, that hurt. Like, what am I, nuts? Cracked your skull, got a concussion, whatever it is.
Yeah.
So what was it that got you to keep going at it and getting better at it and better at it? Like, and so that's the first question. Second question is like, where were there, like, do you remember, I'm sure you, well, we'll see, but you know, is there a moment or moments in your time, in your life, but let's just say a moment where you pushed through and it was like, fucking right, man, I did it.
Mm-hmm.
So tell me about both those.
Yeah. So the thing that drove me was I was in love with the beauty of the thing I was doing. So all these painful things, whatever they were. And I mean, they were painful, like self-inflicted. Like, there were some things that when I was at a skate park in Cleveland and I was trying to do something that was so scary to me that I literally had to punch myself in the face to get myself to do it.
Nice.
Because I would love it. And I'd go, fuck. because I couldn't get myself to do it. It's weird. Your brain wants to do it. Your body is trying to not do it.
Yep.
And you have to somehow also be calm when you're doing it, because you can't do it these tricks in a state of fear. You have to let go. And I was, so I'd go back up on the ramp and I'd literally be punching myself in the leg or in the head to try and feel some of the pain I'm afraid of so that I'll do it. So I was just very much, I was, and it kind of is the why, like I was, for me, there was no option of not doing it, because I really just wanted to do these things. Cause I just was, I thought it was so amazing that I could do them, or I wanted to do it so bad because I could envision it. I could see this trick and how good it would feel to do it. And the other thing, the second part was the feeling of doing it. I mean, come on. I would drive home from Cleveland with like a smile, like plastered on my face, like I was on drugs for like 24 hours. I mean, it was, you know, that's kind of a slightly downside of these sports, is that there's quite an addiction to this like amazing.
Well, feeling. No, but hold on. Okay. So 24 hours of smiling.
Yeah.
Right. Like punching yourself in the head, like fucking, I'm going to do this. Like, that's it, man. And just like almost out of your body experience, sounds like you're just like, that's it, man. I'm going to do this. Okay. So here's what I want to say to that. Mm-hmm. Everybody listening in, this is really important. Okay. And again, some of the stuff, guys, I'm going to tell you this, I'm just riffing here. This is like Matt's pulling out some great stuff here. I hope it is for you guys. Okay. And again, like I said before, you guys want to get more insights in this kind of stuff, you definitely want to get that survival guide. I mean, you know, survive the thrive guide. Okay. Because, you know, we covered off a whole bunch of little principles and things of this nature. This sort of puts it in a very organized fashion. So again, if you want to get that, get into the contractor tips group, answer a couple of questions, because we want to make sure we get the right type of people in, people that are, givers as much as they are takers in a good way. And you can get the survival guide there. If you're already part of the contractor tips group, then man, just type in survival guide, right? DM me, direct message me, guys. I think you guys know what that is, because you're probably connected to me in the Facebook group. Direct message me survival guide and we'll get that out to you. Okay. And again, we got some training happening on that, tonight. And what's the date? It's April 1st, right? Right, guys. And this is no trick, no fool's game. So with that being said, here's where my point is. Just like you can't give up in getting yourself help, you know, mental health help, okay? Never give up on that, guys, okay? Because there are people out there that are going through it, have gone through it, and gotten on the other side. Mark my words, okay? And that's one of the principles we already talked about. The other side of it, which I thought about when I said I had a bit of a breakthrough and then I forgot, was finding things that you're passionate about, okay? Now, people might say to me, Andrew, I heard, you know, other people tell me that. Like, how do I find that? I'm going to tell you how to find that right now. Now, I'm hoping, okay, if you're an entrepreneur on this call, I'm about 99.99% sure that you're going to be able to relate to this. Entrepreneurs are druggies in their own version. In the sense of, we are adrenaline junkies, we are control junkies, we, you know, this thing called addiction. I think, again, everybody has their own definitions of stuff. I mean, being an addict is not really a bad thing in my books. You know, addicted to being happy and like having the best life ever. Addicted to striving to become the best you can become. What the fuck's wrong with that? Okay. So when we look at, you know, you've experienced 24 hours of smiling, coming back from after you just beat the shit out of yourself and like punch yourself in the face. So that means it's in you, Matt. It's in you. You've tasted it. Everybody listening in, think of a moment when you've tasted it. Like, articulate that. Okay? One of the best ways to articulate it is to tell somebody else the story. So Matt, when you were describing that to me, could you feel any of it?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I feel a big buzz coming.
Right. Right. So, and man, you didn't just go and, you know, haul off and, on a bong or something. No, you didn't. It's in you. That means it's hardwired in you. And it depends on how deep it is, but it's there. You've tasted it. Okay. And it's that taste that allowed you to go back again and, you know, fucking you know, come back many, many times without a smile on your face, I'm sure, going, fuck, man, that didn't go as I wanted, right? But then you went back again and again and again. And you did this for what, a month? No, you did it for what, years? True?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Right, and you got better and better and better at it, true? Mm-hmm. Okay, so everybody listening in on this, okay? You've got to find those moments and those stories, okay? You got to find those moments and stories. And I'm fucking swear to God, this is God's honest truth. So on the weekend, I'll just highlight the principle right now, and then I'll tell the quick little story. It's that fuel that gives you resiliency. It's that fuel that makes you tough as shit. Okay. That back in the day for me, everybody has their own stories. For me, it was, you know, that one, I got many of them, but that one bully, hey, it picked on me. I said, well, you're going to get yours one of these fucking days. And this bully guy went on for like a couple of years until something happened. I started getting bigger and stronger. And the day happened. I'm not trying to promote violence, guys. But yeah, I'm going to be honest with you. It was a good day when I beat the shit out of that guy. And I could have really beat him up, but I chose not to. And I just said, remember, I told you that this would happen. It was a victory, okay? So remember your victories, guys, because you have it fucking in you, okay, to persevere, okay? You're all going to look back at this and say, I did either A, I sat on my ass, did nothing, sucked my head in the fucking sand, or B, I'm just going to keep doing how I did it and live this freaking roller coaster. Oh, economy goes up. Oh, I'm too busy. Economy goes down. Oh, I'm too slow. Oh, like fucking never happy, never off the fucking ride. Okay. And it's a bad ride. It's not like, oh, that was a good roller coaster ride. I paid for that. No, it's like, get me off this thing. Or you're going to do something different and look at things differently. But no matter what, to choose that path of resiliency, of perseverance, of like, go ahead, knock me down, motherfucker. Go ahead, knock me down. Because when I get back up, it's going to hurt. Or if you do knock me down, trust me, this is going to sting. You're going to remember knocking me down. And I'm not talking always about violence, but that, guys, that's a little bit of what goes through my head. I grew up with two older brothers, typical Irish, like I shouldn't say typical. My dad, I mean, right out of a textbook, my, you know, fighting in the barn, grew up on a farm, and dad going, you want to fight in the barn? Okay, 3 rounds. What? What are you talking about? 3 rounds. Like people might think, oh my God, that was abuse. No, fuck. I look back at it and go, made me stronger, you know? Like, you know what I mean? And it's that kind of stuff that's gotta that can fuel you guys to like, I wouldn't say crush anxiety, but fucking at least give yourself a really good fighting chance of like, fuck off. I'm not gonna get freaked out about this. Okay, stock market went down. Great, bring it, man. I'm going to freaking make this the best opportunity to invest because I know when we come out of this, I'm going to be doing freaking great. So screw it or bring it. Like, look at those times when you pushed through and were having the crap kicked out of you. Everybody listening in, and this is directed to you too, Matt. Mm-hmm. And know that you got through it. And when you did get through it, you smiled for 24 hours. And we're like, oh my God, that was the best feeling ever. So here's my little story. I'm going to start wrapping this up. So I bought this side-by-side UTV. I bought this farm. Okay, guys, this little mini farm. This is like my new project. Like, again, Andrew, never going to be satisfied? Nope. And everybody listening in, mark my words, but vision, I'm going to make it a retreat. And Matt's going to be one of the main people that's going to help make it a retreat. So we can have these retreats. Come to my little farm, 10 people, 12 people, and like get away fucking in the middle of the bush, log cabin. Sit down the fire, shoot the shit, get some of the stuff off our chest, know that you're not alone. So yeah, trust me, that's coming. Is it there yet? Nope. Gonna be a lot of work? Yep. Perfect. Bring it. So here we are with this UTV. And I said to my friends, I said, let's go for a ride in this UTV. I want to show you this really steep hill. Now the snow's been melting here, you know, so it's really wet. We go down this hill. We go back up it. And my two buddies go, there's no way you're going to get up that hill. So everybody, you have your own little things that drive you. That's my thing. Now that's a curse. But when somebody says, Andrew, you can't do it, I'm like, yeah, you fucker. And I don't mean like in a negative way to them, but I'm like in my head, oh yeah, that's what I need. So find the thing, whatever that statement is, you know, that drives it. For you, Matt, it's like that fucking, what is that punch in the face? I mean, you know, I wouldn't be doing that every day, but like, what is that thing that like it said, I'm literally going to punch myself in the face because I'm going to get this fucking thing done. Like what you write that down, capture that because it's in you, mm-hmm. right? Until you're in the ground, dude, it's still in you. You just got to go find it again.
Yeah. Right?
So whatever that is, for me, it's like somebody, you know, you can't do this, Andrew. Yeah. Fuck off. Oh, Andrew, everybody around me. Oh, businesses are failing. Oh, you know, and then I hear other, you know, some contractors we talk to that are looking to become part of the family. Oh, you know, you don't understand, Andrew. Dude, I do understand. I fucking get it. It's the best opportunity you can ever fucking have. You're going to change things or not, or you're going to face this head on and go, I'm going to become stronger. So here we are with this UTV going up this freaking hill. Go up. Okay. Start coming up to the steepest pitch. Can't get up. Guys go, see, told you. I thought it was only about five times. Then my wife said, Jen, did Mark tell you about what happened? Yeah. I said, yeah, it took us like five times. She's like, five times? What are you talking about? Mark said, you must have tried at least 10 plus times. What? She's like, yeah. And then I was like, one, two. Oh yeah, it's like 12 times. She's like, you don't even know when you get into this state. I'm like, yeah, we're getting up this fucking hill. So he's like, he said this thing to me. He goes, Andrew, yeah, this one track is not spinning that well. I was like, so I didn't have an true locked 4x4. Okay, guys. So I put in locked 4x4. And this fucking thing just like, and instead of matting it, this is a good lesson. Instead of matting it, when I first did, I matted it, tire spinning. All you guys that are big ATV or 4x4 guys, you'll be like, Andrew, you're not supposed to go up it fast. You're supposed to go up it slow. But natural intuition is what? Give it. Right, Matt? Right? Yeah. Pedal to the metal if you're stuck. Oh, yeah, the more fucking gas down, you're going to go up. No, the more you're going to get fucking stuck. Isn't it interesting, eh? Doing the opposite of what we'd naturally think to do, right? Actually works sometimes, okay? So I go really slow. Like, I mean, fucking creeping slow. Like, and I go, I'm going slower, and so I'm getting further and further as I'm going slower. There's a principle. I'm going further and further by slowing down and slowing down. People are like, what? Yeah, getting further up the hill, taking me more time, but I'm going slower. So my distance has increased. I get up over this hill. I swear to God, Matt, it was your 24-hour thing. Okay? We fucking high-five and jump. We're just like, oh my God. Like, we're just like kids again. Like, literally, I was like, I was like that 13-year-old kid where my dad said, there's no way, Andy, you can ride that horse. And I said, I'm going to fucking ride that horse. And I jump, you know, up the fence. Jump on the freaking horse. He's like, what are you doing? And I rode the horse. I was like, I'm the champion, right? Right? Hence, part of the name of Proffer Contractors members is champion CEOs. Because we're fucking champions, man. We're champions take a beating. And they get on top of the hill. Now, they might take them a long time. They might have to do a lot of different, blood, sweat, and tears. Dude, biking, blood, sweat, and tears, right? Many times, I'm sure you had a few tears. Mm-hmm. Okay. But it's that kind of shit that when you get to the top, it's like, it's worthy of the cup. Right. So it's that for me, right. This is the last little principle. Find those moments in time where you experience, you know, and passion is one word, but it's those moments, in my personal opinion, that create passion. That's my personal opinion. You don't go, oh, I'm passionate about this. It was some other things in your life that you tasted where you're like, I think if I do this thing, I'm going to experience those things again. And that's what drives the shit out of me. And that's why when times are like this, I'm like, man, I've been physically had the crap kicked out of me. You know, I've got other people around me dealing with challenges around dying. And cancer and disease. I've got two beautiful kids. Yes, and we got challenges and stuff that we're dealing with, for sure. But what a great fucking opportunity. Mm-hmm. Step it up. To know that when you get, you know, when you stand up on that hill, that it's like, you're like, it's worthy, right? Like, what a fucking great feeling. And the very last thing that I've had to learn is this. Knowing those moments allows you to enjoy the journey of going through the painful points. I'll say that again. Knowing those moments of standing up and going, I fucking did it. I did it. When everybody else said I couldn't do it, even myself, I doubted myself and I did it. And it took me months, if not years, if not whatever, broken this, broken that. And like, I did it. To look back and go, the only reason that I was able to do it is because of the shit that I had to go through. So when you can start I think that's a different level of thinking, in my personal opinion, is that when you can start recognizing that, going, I got through all that. Fuck, man, that was, man, we carried the cup so many moments of carrying the cup, whatever that is for you. And don't think it's just business. Like for you, Matt, if you it's the BMXing, maybe, okay? And just going, fucking, I did it. So what's the other things that I can go and get bruised on, get broken fucking bones on, feel like it's worthy of being punching myself in the face, that's going to allow me to appreciate those moments as I'm going through them, so that when I stand up there on the stand, mentally, physically, whatever, that you go, fuck, man, that was, what a great fucking journey that was. Like, mm-hmm. Fuck, we did it, right? 12 times, it was 5 times. No, Andrew, it was 12 times that you fucking tried. But on the 12th time, it's like, fucking, we did it. And you're like a kid again. Like, I'm feeling it right now. And that's where you feel like you can take on the world, man. Is that no matter what the world gives you, I think these opportunities and you feeling anxiety or other people feeling anxiety, it's okay to feel that. But understand and recognize what you fucking have gone through prior to this. People are a lot stronger and more resilient, especially entrepreneurs listening in on this, than I think we ever let ourselves be. Because you taught me an amazing thing about pausing. Like when we had that session, that mindset mastery session, and you do it for all of our champion CEOs, like, why do you think it's so effective when you get them to slow down, Matt? Why?
Oh, because people just don't do it. So it's such a powerful thing to feel, because we just don't do it. And when you do it, you're like, oh, this is something I can do. And it just feels amazing.
Explain to people what slowing down, like.
So slowing means. Down. Yeah. It's literally just, okay. So the way I start sessions is like, we put our attention up into our heads where we're conducting all this business from, all this heady stuff. So you're in your head, you're problem solving, you're talking, intellectual, cognitive, whatever. And you slow down and you start to get into your body. And what happens is you start to feel your body, literally. And it's like returning to a part of yourself that is a huge part that has its own brain, essentially, in your gut and in your nerves, whatever. And you're suddenly getting new information from your body, and you're literally checking in with yourself. Like, you're actually like being like, oh, hey, this is me. I'm here. And it just feels this like relieving feeling of like, okay, I'm not just my head that's worried about all these things. You know, it's not just a story. It's not just this anxiety or this business I have to do, these million things I've got to do. There's this whole other part of me that is breath, and that is slowness, and that is stillness. And it's kind of connected to just kind of nature and just basic human rhythms and stuff. So,
you know, dude, it's funny you say this, because I was up at the farm just the other day, because I had to run up there because we got this barn that we're looking at renovating. It was, long story short, the walls potentially, like, I'm trying to prevent the wall from caving in, blah, 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 blah. Anyways, I go up there. This is like totally to what you're saying. I go up there and I come out and I stop. And by the way, everybody, we just got this place. I've never seen it in the summer. There's a shitload of snow up there. I stopped. I almost feel like having a tear. That's how positive it was. And I hear this sound. I hear this water. And I look over, and I know that there's this creek over here. And I'm like, man, is that ever flowing? like, wow, what a sound. Beautiful. So I just walked over. I looked at it. I'm like, man, this is so cool. Then I come back to the barn. I'm like, wait a second. I hear that sound at another place. So now I'm like, it's like an adventure. Where's that coming from? Dude, I can't wait to have you up there. Like, it's going to be amazing. Okay. So I start walking in the bush, right? We got like 200 acres. So walking in the bush. And I'm like, holy shit, there's another river that's flowing. Now, that river didn't flow before. I knew there's this big creek, like this, you know, sort of fair-sized valley, like in the middle of the forest. And I said to my wife, like, man, she's like, I wonder if water flows through here. And I'm like, well, it looks like it does. But I'm not sure. Well, man, the fucking water, it's like a fucking Niagara Falls, like type of thing, okay? Like micro version. And anyways, I'm in there. I'm looking at, I literally FaceTime my wife. And I'm showing her like this. I'm like, oh my God, I wish you were here. And just being with nature, right? This freaking little red squirrel comes down. He's like, you know, remember Chip and Dale? From Disney, I'm dating myself, Chip and Dale from Walt Disney. So there's this one, then there's this other one. I'm looking at this big cedar tree, and they're like right there, and like, hey, man, like, what the fuck are you doing here? You know, like, this is our turf, man. Like, and they're like, you know, like they're standing like these little freaking squirrels, and they're like, hey, man, I'm just like, thanks, guys. Sorry, guys. I actually talked to them. I'm like, sorry, guys. I'll let you be. I'll get out of your turf, right? Right. And then I go up and I'm watching this water, and I'm just like, like I've felt it just right now. I'm just like, I'm like, I could literally curl up. This sounds weird. I was like, my wife said to me, she goes, man, that was amazing. You could see in your face, you're just so happy. I'm like, babe, I could have literally curled up on the right by the roots of the tree. I could have gone for a nap. What? I'm like, no, seriously. Like, I just like, oh, this feels so good. And that's freaking just going for a walk.
Yeah.
So, I mean, my experience with you doing that mindset mastery thing, that I think it's so important that we pause.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Yeah. And really reflect. So any last words you wanted to say, Matt?
Yeah. Just a quick takeaway. Yeah. Pause, slow down, but also do, write in a book, journal a little bit, you know, like you're saying, do take account of what you're actually doing. Because I noticed this the other day, it was like, there's so many things that I don't even give myself credit for or don't acknowledge. And if you don't acknowledge them or you don't take the time to think about it, they literally don't exist, or they may as well not exist. So it's like, you've got to just like, even at the end of the day, write 5 things that you did that you actually did, so that you're actually cognitively aware of, like, you know, little changes, micro changes, micro wins, you know, celebrate.
I got up out of bed. I brushed my teeth.
Yeah, whatever it is.
No, like, seriously, I remember this dealing with one of my family members going through like rehab and stuff like this. It's like, a win is a win, you know? And this, you know, starting to wrap this up is this, like, this brings me back to the storytelling, right? Of like those moments where you experienced the natural adrenaline rush, right? Like, personally, and I might have some people that don't agree with me. They're totally cool, man. I'm no psychiatrist here or whatever, right? I'm like, get fucking addicted to that again. So, Matt, get fucking addicted to that again. Like, seriously. Like, honestly, I'm 50 years old. I'm going to be 50 years old in June. Okay? And, like, I just went out and bought a freaking UTV. And I'm a kid again. Like, be a fucking kid again. Climb up the hill. Get dirty. Like, it doesn't have to be just business, guys. Like, whatever that thing is that first of all, recognize that you have it in you. So sort of wrapping this up, like, recognize that you have so much in you that you've forgotten about, right? And any entrepreneur, Matt, you're an entrepreneur, dude. Any entrepreneur, you're fucking crazy to be an entrepreneur to begin with. We're all nuts. 80% failure rate? Who fucking signs up to that? We did. Why? Because we're crazy, right? And it's okay. People are like, hey, Houston, you're crazy. Yeah, I'm crazy. No, like, you're crazy. That's awesome, man. Crazy is fucking fun. Like, you know, and recognize that you have this thing called passion in you. You've experienced it at many points, okay? Even if it's only once, right? Many points. And guys, seriously, like seeing my kids get born, holy shit. That was like, woo, head exploded, blown off. It's in me. Oh, another time. Oh, another time. Oh, last weekend. Oh, like, and then go, like, it's in you. It's in you. So you've gotten this far, right? Guys, you're many, many people listening to this are struggling. You can get through this shit, okay? And getting through this shit, does that mean like you might have to lay off everybody? Does that mean you might have to get on the tools? Does that mean it might just be you in the truck? I don't know. What's your definition of success? I'll tell you what, I'll fucking do whatever it takes. I'll do whatever it takes. Nothing is below me. I was cleaning the fucking toilets yesterday. Can I afford to hire somebody? Yeah. Am I still paying my cleaners, even though they don't come? Yep. What? Yeah. Because that's, I know they're struggling. Because I'm cleaning the fucking toilet yesterday. Awesome. I'm fucking shoveling, picking out shit at this farm. Old shit that's been sitting there for 30, 40 years. I don't care. Nothing's below us. Remember that. Nothing's below us. And when you can come, when you start, you know, you doing that stuff and doing whatever it takes is you actually getting through this. It's not like, oh, the end is once everything's back to normal. Fuck, it's never going to be back to the way it was before. Get over it. Okay? Get over it. But what you got to do is get through it and recognize you're getting through it. Waking up in the morning, going to work, doing things differently, looking at where the opportunities are, recognizing that you can do this. Guys, get that survival guide. You're freaking out of your minds. You're talking like probably 20 years plus. More. You know, I might be, you think I'm exaggerating, I'm not. Some of these people have been doing this stuff, running their contracting business for 30 years, and they're giving you tips and tricks in that fucking thing. So you got 20, 30, 40 fucking years worth of knowledge in there. Oh, I think I'll figure it out on my own. Why the fuck, why would you do that? This is one of those times in life where it's good to cheat. Go get the answer sheet. Okay, so go to the contractor tips group. Get in there if you get in. Okay, we've gotten so many people trying to get in there. I'm sorry that there's a bit of a delay, but hey, man, welcome to life. Okay, that means it's probably a good place to be. Secondly, you know, if you are in there, once you get in there, type in, you know, the survival guide, because guys, seriously, fucking leapfrog decades to days. Right, Matt? Mm-hmm. So any last words, Matt, to this point?
No, just thank you everyone for listening and hanging in this long, and I hope you got something out of it. I hope you feel the kind of, I guess, solidarity that we're expressing and that we have for you guys and everyone going through this thing. And also that any kind of energy can be generated with certain tricks and tools. And you're gonna feel up, you're gonna feel down. I feel up right now. I feel connected to you. I feel I don't feel my anxiety right now. I feel motivated by the future thought of going to the farm and doing fun things in the future. That whatever time we're gonna lose here, that there'll be lots of more time for amazing things. And that's kind of that's something that I'm taking away with this is, oh yeah, don't forget that there's things in the future that you're looking forward to that you can't wait to do and that they're coming. It's just
totally, man. And appreciate, right? Appreciate what you have right now. Mm-hmm. And by the way, I think we're going to appreciate that a hell of a lot more when it happens, like how lucky we are to be able to have gatherings. How lucky we are that, you know, we're able to, you know, be healthy, right? That we're able to, you know, do something about this right now. Like, yeah, you'd be an absolute fool not to distance yourself, but that doesn't mean business stops, right? So guys, look at this is Andrew Houston from Profit Contractors with Matt, the freaking mindset master. And, you know, guys, get through this, push through this, get stronger, get faster, and you have it. You have all the ability to do it. You've gotten this far, right? There's no reason why you can't keep moving further. And reach out for help. Don't do it alone. And that's it. That's all, man. So this is another podcast. We'll catch you guys on the flip side right from the trenches, baby. Later.
Thank you guys.
Thanks, man. Ciao.